Hey, how are you doing? Today's lecture is going to be all about enzymes. So let's get started. So we already saw one video where we covered certain topics of enzymes. Let's move on. In today's video, we're going to cover enzyme inhibition, enzyme specificity, and the topic of coenzymes. Alright, let's start with enzyme inhibition. So enzyme inhibitions are basically of three types, that is reversible, irreversible and allosteric. Let's look into what each of these are. Reversible, as the name tells you, can be reversed, right? So once the inhibitor is removed, normal enzyme activity can continue. Reversible enzyme inhibition is further divided into three types, that is competitive, non-competitive and uncompetitive. Let's look into each of these. Now in competitive inhibition, basically what happens is that your substrate and inhibitor are structurally similar. So the inhibitor competes with the substrate for the active site of the enzyme. They both compete for the same site. Alright? So now, what the graph would look like is this. What are we seeing in this graph? The Vmax for competitive inhibition remains the same. That is, there is no change in the reaction occurring. But the Km is increasing. Why? As we discussed earlier, Km is the substrate concentration required to reach your present at your half of the Vmax, right? So now what is happening is that you have an inhibitor trying to bind at the active site of your enzyme. Also, the substrate is trying to bind there. So obviously you'll require a higher concentration of the substrate to be able to compete with that inhibitor and bind at the active site, right? Which is why your Km increases. An example of competitive inhibition is succinate dehydrogenase enzyme, for which the inhibitor is malonate. Alright, malonate or malonic acid acts as a competitive inhibitor for SDH, that's succinate dehydrogenase. Then we have non-competitive inhibition. Now in non-competitive inhibition, what happens is that your inhibitor comes and binds with the enzyme, but not at the active site, it is at another site, any other site other than the active site. Alright, so now in non-competitive inhibition, your inhibitor may bind with the enzyme directly, or it could bind with the enzyme substrate complex that has already formed. Alright, now in non-competitive inhibition, what happens is your Km value remains the same, but Vmax increases. Alright? So your graph looks something like this. Km value remains the same, but your Vmax is increasing. Alright? Because your active site is free, so your substrate is free to bind, there is nothing inhibiting that, the binding of the substrate. However, once the inhibitor binds at the other site, other than the activator, it inhibits the catalysis of the reaction, which is why your Vmax increases, right? Alright. An example of non-competitive inhibition is heavy metals. Alright. Heavy metals like silver, lead, mercury, etc., they inhibit cysteinyl sulfhydryl groups. Alright? We move on to the third type of reversible inhibition, that is uncompetitive enzyme inhibition. Now in uncompetitive enzyme inhibition, your Km value decreases and Vmax decreases as well. Both of these decrease. In uncompetitive inhibition, your inhibitor binds with a preformed enzyme substrate complex. It does not bind with a free enzyme, it binds with the enzyme substrate complex. Alright? Now, an example of uncompetitive inhibition is placental alkaline phosphatase, placental alkaline phosphatase, which is inhibited by phenylalanine. Alright? So that was reversible inhibition. We move on to irreversible inhibition. Now, irreversible, as you can see from the name, it means that the inhibition cannot be reversed. Once the inhibitor combines with the enzyme, it does not separate again. Normal activity does not occur after that. Alright? So now, certain examples of irreversible are a drug called disulfiram. Disulfiram is used in the treatment of alcoholism. What happens is, it inhibits the enzyme called aldehyde dehydrogenase. Alright, so what happens is, your acetaldehyde then accumulates, which makes the person feel sick and it leads them to alcohol avoidance. That's why disulfiram is used for alcoholism treatment. Then you have cyanide. Now, cyanide inhibits the enzyme cytochrome oxidase. This is highly important in your respiration process, right? In the biological oxidation. Okay, so it inhibits this cytochrome oxidase enzyme, because of which ATP is not formed and it can cause death within minutes. Alright, then we have fluoride. Fluoride inhibits enolase. Enolase is an enzyme in the glycolytic pathway. Again, if this is inhibited, your glycolysis is inhibited, and that means your carbohydrate oxidation is inhibited, ATP formation is hampered, and that creates problems again. Right? Now, there's a term called suicide inhibition. Suicide inhibition is a special type of irreversible inhibition where a particular inhibitor combines with the enzyme, and then that enzyme itself becomes a more enhanced inhibitor. So it is not the inhibitor itself that is causing the inhibition. It is the inhibitor enzyme complex that is further inhibiting the enzyme itself. Alright? So now, an example of this is alloxanthin. Okay. Now, there's an enzyme called xanthin oxidase present in purine degradation, right? So, alloxanthin is formed, which further inhibits xanthin oxidase, and that causes, prevents rather, the formation of uric acid, and the degradation of purines is inhibited. Alright? So, let's move on to our third type of enzyme inhibition, that is allosteric inhibition. Now, allosteric inhibition basically means that the inhibitor binds at an allosteric site, a site other than the active site, and that causes inhibition. It is a non-covalent, could be reversible bond. So, examples of allosteric inhibition are, you have statin drugs, for example, lovastatin, right, which inhibits HMG-CoA reductase enzyme. And that is used to decrease cholesterol levels. Alright? Then we have tenofovir, which inhibits reverse transcriptase enzyme. That is used against HIV, right? To prevent the multiplication of HIV virus. Then we have captopril. Captopril inhibits the enzyme ACE. ACE stands for angiotensin converting enzyme. So this is used as a treatment of hypertension. Alright? So that covers enzyme inhibition. We had three types: reversible, irreversible, and allosteric. Reversible was further divided into competitive, non-competitive, and uncompetitive. Alright, so let's move on to our next topic, that is enzyme specificity. We spoke earlier about how enzymes are specific, right? So there are three different types of specificities in enzymes: stereospecificity, reaction specificity, and substrate specificity. Let's look into each of them. Stereospecificity, which is also called optical specificity. So basically, when the substrate is structurally same, but So the molecular formula is same, but the structural configuration is different. It is called stereoisomerism. And enzymes having stereo specificity differentiate between these stereoisomers, right? So for example, you have L amino oxidase and D amino oxidase, which differentiate or act on L amino acids and D amino acids respectively. L amino acid oxidase would never act on a D amino acid, right? They're highly specific about what stereoisomer they act on. You have hexokinase, which acts on D hexoses, right? Now, an important point that you must remember is that isomerases do not exhibit stereo specificity. Why is that? Because isomerases are specifically for the interconversion of various different isomers. So they are not specific about which isomer they are reacting with. Alright? We then move on to the next, that is reaction specificity. Here, you are talking about a single substrate that undergoes various different reactions, but each different reaction is catalyzed by a different enzyme. So the enzyme is specific about which reaction it is performing. Alright? So supposing we have amino acid as the substrate. An amino acid can undergo transamination by transaminase enzyme, oxidative decarboxylation, decarboxylation. It can undergo various different, it can undergo racemization. And each of these will have a different enzyme. Right? So that is the meaning of reaction specificity. Fairly simple. Let's move on to the next, that is substrate specificity. Substrate specificity, as you can understand from the name, means that the enzyme is specific about what substrate it is binding with. This is divided into three different types: absolute, relative, and broad. Alright? What is the meaning of each of these? Absolute means that an enzyme reacts with only one particular enzyme, one particular substrate, right? So for example, if you take the example of glucokinase. Now glucokinase reacts acts on only glucose to form glucose 6-phosphate, alright? We then have relative. Relative substrate specificity means that the enzyme acts on a particular group. It is specific to the group present in the substrate rather than the entire substrate as a whole. So it's also called group specificity. Alright, so for example, you have trypsin and chymotrypsin. Trypsin acts on peptide bonds related to arginine. Alright, arginine and lysine. Whereas chymotrypsin is specific to aromatic amino acids. Alright? So it is not specific to any one particular amino acid or one particular compound. It is specific to a group, that is any compound containing aromatic amino acids, chymotrypsin can act on that and break the peptide bond. Simple? We then have broad specificity, broad substrate specificity. Alright, which is another group specificity where substrates are closely structurally related. For example, you have hexokinase, which acts on glucose, fructose, mannose and glucosamine, but it does not act on galactose. Alright, so there is a structural resemblance between the four that it acts on, because of which hexokinase can act on all four of them. So these are the enzyme specificities for you. Okay, so let's move on to the last topic for today, that's coenzymes. What are coenzymes? Coenzymes are the non-protein, organic, low molecular weight, dialyzable substance associated with enzyme function. Okay, so it's non-protein. It's got a low molecular weight. It is separated from the holoenzyme, from the enzyme, by dialysis. Alright. So let's go back to a concept that we had covered in the first video. That is, holoenzyme is formed by apoenzyme. Apoenzyme is your protein part. And a non-protein part which is your coenzyme. Right? So coenzyme, non-protein, plus apoenzyme, that's protein, forms the holoenzyme, which is your functionally active enzyme. Right? Now coenzyme, we spoke about it earlier, can be of two types, that is cofactor or prosthetic group. When it is not tightly bound, when it is loosely bound by non-covalent bonds, it is called a cofactor. When it is tightly bound, non-separable by covalent bonds, it is called prosthetic group, right? So what are the properties of coenzymes? Coenzymes are also called second substrate or co-substrate, right? They are also called co-substrate because they have an affinity for the enzyme which is comparable to that of the substrate. Your coenzyme also undergoes catalytic changes during the reaction, but the coenzyme is regenerated and it forms the original coenzyme again by the end of the reaction. On the other hand, your substrate undergoes catalytic change and forms the product, right? So that is the difference between the two. Then we have that they perform the function of transferring groups or atoms during a reaction. For example, they transfer hydrogen group, carbon dioxide, amino acids, acyl groups, etc. There's a long list of groups and atoms that they transfer during the reaction to facilitate the reaction, right? Then they act as substrate shuttle. That is, once they transport the substrate from one part of the cell to another. For example, you have the coenzyme UDP. UDP transports glucose by forming a UDP glucose complex. Alright? So these are the properties of your coenzymes. Now coenzymes can be listed under four groups. You have B complex derivatives or vitamin derived coenzymes. Mainly they come from vitamin B. Then you have non-vitamin coenzymes, nucleotide coenzymes and protein coenzymes. So under vitamin B complex derivatives, you have TPP, alright, that comes from vitamin B1, that's thiamine. You have NAD, you have NADP, you have FAD, you've heard of these before, right? And we'll come to their uses as well as we move on into the metabolism chapters. Then you have non-vitamin coenzymes. Non-vitamin coenzymes, for example, you have ATP, we know this very well, right? You have CDP, you have UDP, etc. Alright? Then under nucleotide coenzymes, you again have FAD, NAD, etc. Okay? Alright. So then we have our fourth type of coenzymes, the fourth category is protein coenzymes. An example of protein coenzyme is thioreductase. Alright? So these are the types of coenzymes. Now an important point to remember is that specificity of an enzyme does not come from your coenzyme part. In fact, it comes from the apoenzyme part. Coenzyme gives nothing to your specificity of the enzyme. Alright? Now that we've covered these topics, let me quickly summarize it for you. We started with enzyme inhibition, where we had three types, that's reversible, irreversible and allosteric. Then we spoke about enzyme specificity, which was also of three types. There was stereospecificity, reaction specificity and substrate specificity. Lastly, we spoke about coenzymes, right? I hope you liked this video. I hope you understood. You go back to your books and read through this. I'm pretty sure it will become much easier for you to grasp and understand. I'll see you in the next one.